When I was 24 years old, I had just started a career at the New York Post, just graduated from college. Everything was very new and exciting. And then things quickly fell apart. I started behaving in ways that I didn't recognize as myself. I felt out of control. And from there, escalated very quickly, and I started experiencing hallucinations and paranoia. And from there, even devolved even quicker. But I will leave that to the movie to tell the rest of that story, I think. So the disease itself affects the brain in a way that makes memory impossible. So most of that time is lost to me. So I actually had to use kind of skills as a journalist. I'm a journalist by trade. And I had to use those skills to uncover, you know, a lot of that time and relying on other people's recollections. So a lot of those feelings and kind of I couldn't access because they weren't there to begin with. So it was an experience of a journalistic enterprise, really.
Yeah, I read the book and it was amazing. You know, it was a very interesting experience reading it because it's very scary, but it's also very exhilarating from a storyteller's point of view. And I just kind of, you know, I sat back and I just kind of said, you know what, it's very rare that you get to, you know, make a film that will probably save a life. And I think by putting this film out there and dealing with the disease and talking about the disease and highlighting the disease, I think ultimately it will save a life in some way, shape, or form. Like, you know, Susanna's book has saved many lives, I'm sure. And I think, you know, there's a greater good in it. And that's what really attracted me to it, you know.
It's the role of a lifetime to begin with. You know, you get to kind of break a lot of stereotypes that surround people with illnesses. You know, I think Susanna Cahalan is someone who is such a character of strength, someone who can overcome anything, truly. I mean, you know, you see someone who had so much taken away from them, but at the same time, she is so evolving constantly. Even from when we first started talking to now, she's kind of even taken this movie as part of a way to learn even more about what had happened. And so when I read the book and when I read the script and then when I spoke to Susanna, it just felt pertinent to me that this movie was made for a multitude of reasons. And I think above all, you know, it's more than a movie about illness. It's a story about labeling and mislabeling and misunderstanding and how far a misunderstanding can go and how people need to look farther than the books, you know, because no human is just a book. You know, I really wanted to find out who Susanna was, you know, and how real all the relationships that, you know, I had read in different interviews and different things about where she was in her life prior to the anti-NMDA kind of taking hold of her. I really wanted to figure out who she was. And a lot of the questions I asked, she was, you know, she would kind of sit there and go, well, you know, I have puzzled together a lot of pieces that people have told me, and there is stuff that there are black spots. Yeah. And so we were just talking about this earlier today, is that it's funny for her to watch the movie and to kind of the idea that our worlds are kind of melding, and some of the realist depiction of that time that she has visually is the movie.
Yeah, some of my memories now are actually of Chloe doing the things,
which wild.
Is bizarre.
And
you know?
She was on set during some of the most crazy scenes we had to film.
But how do you think I feel? Because I'm looking at two of everyone up here. It's very odd.
And we look a lot alike. If we were talking about that, it's crazy.
It's very strange, definitely.
It's cool. Yeah, you know, we were talking about this today on how this movie really does speak, this whole story really speaks more about labeling and how it is so easy to look at a young woman who lives in New York, who's working as a journalist in New York Post, and say, ah, you know, you have a glass of wine every night. You go out on the weekends like most New Yorkers do. You know, you're obviously writing yourself too hard and you're having a mental breakdown. You know, it's so easy to say that someone just can't, you know, compensate with life, and that's their issue there. And especially as a young woman. You know, it's kind of something we're used to, and you kind of see that in the movie where, you know, she's going, no, I know myself, I know who I am. Her boyfriend's saying, I know who she is, and she's never acted like this before. The New York Post stood behind her because they noticed that she was 16 years old, and they kept saying, you know, they didn't fire her. They didn't go, you know, oh, go home, you're psychotic. They called her family, and they said, something's wrong with the Susanna we know. It's not Susanna anymore. And that just, you know, is something we really want to highlight and make very realize is that, it's, you know, not everything is as it looks, and you can't just point a finger and say you know what's going on with someone until you really, really look deeply into the person and the whole story, not just a little bitty piece of it. So, yeah, that was very pertinent and important to us.
I mean, that was one of the biggest challenges, was not, you know, hijacking the film from a selfish creative point of view. I mean, there is without doubt scope here for a director to come in and let's go into the brain, let's go behind the eyes, let's have it all POV and whatever. But I think for me, the story is just too important, and the disease is too important, and everything around it is too important, and the themes are too important to hijack that with a style that would be distracting, you know? So for me, I just wanted to tell the story. I wanted to put the audience, you know, the camera's always quite away from her, so we're kind of experiencing it through a coworker, another patient in the hospital, you know, fly on the wall type of thing. And I think, you know, I relied on, I remember I spoke to Susanna about sounds and stuff like that and all that. And, you know, I relied on, you know, sound design to take us there. And I also relied on the actors and to take us where we needed to go on a very visceral, real way. Because it's just too important, you know, it's too important to... and look, whether people will like that or not, that was a decision I made, because, you know, the most important thing here is Susanna's story and how that is going to impact people.
We would finish a take and we kind of look at each other and be like, what did we just do?
Because we'd run it. We'd run the whole thing. So
it's almost like a blackout. Like,
yeah, it was a very crazy experience.
It's as hysteric as it looks. I mean, yeah. You know, you have to throw yourself into a state of psychosis that, yeah. Even if you're acting, your brain is, you're still throwing your levels up and down so much, and you kind of are spinning out of control, and it's kind of terrifying.
And we shot this film in like 17 or 18 days, wow. So it's like,
we're long.
Did you go home and pull the covers over your head?
I did. I would just go home and sit with my dog. I remember, like, I used to say to my mom was like, do you want to go see a movie? And I was like, no. I just want to kind of sit and just think. You know, I would just kind of process and say my name and remember who I am. And
do you worry about, because it's almost like you can't be too big with somebody whose brain is ill like this. Like,
well, I mean, that's what I would ask. I would ask Susanna. I'd be like, how big was it? That's what I remember asking you that. I was like, was it as big as we'd want in a movie, or is that going too far? And I mean, I remember you told me a story where she said she remembers looking at, I think it was your editor, and she could like age people. She could stare at them and she thought she was godlike because she could literally make them age by like 50 years in front of her eyes. Uh-huh. And I remember the idea that if that was possible in real life, then what couldn't we depict? Yeah. You know, how far was too far? Yeah.
So I was the 217th person to be diagnosed with what's called anti-NMDA receptor autoimmune encephalitis. And that disease itself was named in 2005 and really, was described in 2005 and really named in 2007. And I was treated in 2009. So had that been prior to 2005, I definitely would not be sitting at this table here right now. So I got very, very lucky to, you know, it seemed like a harrowing journey, which it was, but many people out there face far more harrowing journeys than I did, and some of them are actually going to be at the premiere tonight. But it's a kind of testament to the fact that we need really pliable, interested doctors who are also listening and also, you know, reading up on the literature. You know, that's one thing that, not only is he an amazing listener and an amazing clinician, but he also is a researcher on top of that. So I really benefited from the kind of, from that and getting to him as swiftly as I did.
I think anyone can really understand what it means to be misunderstood and labeled. Obviously, I could say that I'm put on a pedestal and I'm seen above all, but, you know, I think every person's story is true to themselves, and you know that's you know, I don't ever want to separate myself from the group, because my labeling and my misunderstandings, they're just as real and just as serious as anyone else's. So yeah, it's hard to have someone pick apart everything you say, but that's why this movie can hopefully crack people's minds open and tell them to stop just judging and taking someone for something they're not when you don't even know who they are.